Hello and welcome to Talking Development. Today we're exploring how science and technology can transform a nation's future. I'm thrilled to be joined by Dr. Marie-Angélique Sène, head of the Vaccine Research Center at the Dakar Pasteur Institute, a brilliant engineer whose work spans material science, mechanical systems, quantum physics, and micro-nanotechnology. Dr. Sen's career demonstrates how advanced STEM expertise can tackle critical development challenges in innovative ways. In Senegal, where traditional development paths are being reimagined, her work exemplifies the untapped potential of scientific advancement. Marie-Angélique, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
You have a very impressive background. But tell me, how did you get started on this journey of STEM and to become the head of this research center?
Yes. Well, I was always excited by biology. I remember a cell biology course where we could see like some proteins, motor proteins, moving along through the nucleus, and they were actually walking on kind of a rails. So it was really fascinating to me. I first wanted to be a doctor, a surgeon, but I cannot stand the sight of blood. So I had to rethink my career path. So I was focusing more on the side part, the support system behind it, STEM or scientific field that could help me still contribute in areas of health, agriculture, etc. So I came across nanotechnology. It was really fascinating how we could use nanotechnology or quantum physics to actually push the boundaries of what is possible and actually leapfrog in certain areas. So I knew from the get-go that I wanted to go in there. So I started learning material engineering just to get the foundation, then moved into quantum physics, then nanotechnology. It allowed me to actually intervene in different areas, not only health, but also agriculture, new energies, IT, and so on, just using nanotechnology as a catalyzer.
The government of Senegal and the leadership of Senegal has set a very bold new vision for the country, which really focuses on improving the prospects for economic growth throughout the country and through territorial development, but also really focusing on job creation. How can STEM and the field of your research help the government and the people of Senegal transform its economy?
Exactly, like just started with health. Having nanotechnology or nanoparticles sometimes will help us create some diagnostic devices for early diagnosis of cancer or other NCDs. We're also using AI to design our vaccines based on the local need of our population and the local characteristic of our population is extremely important. For agriculture, on the other side, we have different types of soils. Mm-hmm. Sometimes climate change affects how crops will evolve and the yield of our products. They don't need to be expert in the field. Actually, these technologies help break the barriers. It's not only for the elite. Mm-hmm. We have to make it accessible to everyone, and they could actually adapt what they need to adapt to get good yields in their production and respond to the needs of the populations.
Fantastic. And in energy?
In energy, there is a lot to do. Senegal has a lot of potential when it comes to solar energy. Mm-hmm. In nanotechnology, for example, micro nanotechnology, we can do something like doping materials. You mm-hmm. dope the material you use for solar panels mm-hmm. so that it makes it more efficient mm-hmm. and respond to the need based on sometimes you have environmental hurdles. Mm-hmm. Here, the dust, etc., the wind and the rain in general. Mm-hmm. So we could adapt to what we have here in Senegal or in Africa at large and actually provide solutions. Mm-hmm. When it comes to the resources we naturally have, but we cannot exploit fully. And even like fuel, now we are starting to produce, so we could adapt the fuel, adapt the capacity or the conditions of production to make it more efficient, but less impactful in our environment, just thinking sustainability.
Fantastic and fascinating. I want to go back to vaccines. Of course, very recently, in the last few years, the world has been really confronted with the challenge of developing vaccines quickly. And I know that it generated also a lot of discussions here on the continent about being able to be a leader in and of itself as a continent on vaccine development. Tell me a little bit on how you see this horizon, because it's something that we at the World Bank Group would very much like to support, and we would very much like to see how we can partner to be able to make this a reality within a very short period of time. So how do you see the scope and the potential for the continent to quickly develop a variety of different vaccines?
Yeah, that is really an interesting and important question, because it was timely. The time came for governments and institutions to realize that we need to focus on developing, having more sovereignty in certain areas, especially in health. Research is the foundation of all of it. We could transfer some technologies, of course, but unless we have a good research that accompanies that transfer, that makes sure that people, the population here, and the researchers that are here, they take ownership of those technologies and start developing their own, we won't make it to sovereignty correctly. So it's important that we have that investment, that we have that dedication, dedicated facilities or centers where young populations can learn from it, can grow in that area, and actually can invest their time and energy into trying to solve local problems. You need to tackle them early on so that it doesn't spread and become a global threat. So it's really important to get that capacity to contain whatever is happening at the local level that is not necessarily yet a global threat, but is really important for our population. It helps also economical development. It helps maintain certain level of, let's say, independence, and we don't rely on too much imports, because then we become weakened by that situation, and it creates, and we had unfortunately events during COVID. We had outbreaks of measles because the vaccines are mostly made in India. Yeah. They weren't accessible. Even people from my team had issues getting vaccinated to be able to work on the measles vaccines. And that's why we really need to invest on those efforts, getting transfers, collaborations between institutions, getting policies that actually incentivize those type of tech transfers, but also joint ventures. Yeah. Where we could actually expand the capacity, but also having that approach of capacity building. Yeah. That also locally, we need to have something that remains and that can thrive on its own.
Wonderful. I look forward to having more discussions with you on this in the near future. How do you see girls' interest in STEM? And what can be done to incentivize more girls to pursue a STEM education and a career in STEM?
Well, at the moment, I think that girls are not enough exposed to STEM. It arrives too late when they have to choose after high school which universities or which graduate studies they want to do, which is unfortunate, because I remember even for me, when I discovered nanotechnology, I wanted to do that. There is that societal bias. People were saying, are you sure you want to go into that field? If you go in there, men will flee. Thankfully, I had a mom that is strong enough to push me and to achieve my goals. So I was just like, I don't care. Let them flee, I will just focus on that career. And usually when you see women thriving in STEM, it's because they got that little push from someone in their environment, but it's not enough. We need more role models. We need women, young girls, to see that actually it's possible. There are a lot of scientists, women scientists, that can thrive in that area and still maintain their whatever other applications they have, maybe family or so on and so forth. It doesn't need to be one or the other. The other aspect is also, as I said, they are exposed too late in their study path. So education has to focus also on integrating STEM early on in their career, but not just theoretical STEM. It has to be also hands-on, practice, having internships in some industries, or having mentorship programs, incentives, PhDs, scholarships, so that they can not only learn that STEM exists, that it's great, that they could use it to solve their everyday problem, but also they are already exposed to real life challenges, and once they graduate, they are actually ready to tackle those challenges.
That's wonderful. You're going to have to continue being an advocate, because you do it so well, I can tell.
I'll try.
Thank you so much for joining me today.
Yeah, thank you.
And thank you for tuning in. This episode offers a glimpse into Senegal's future, showing how STEM education can drive inclusive growth, create new industries, and tackle development challenges. At the World Bank, we recognize that science and technology are critical enablers for sustainable development. In Senegal specifically, we're supporting initiatives that bridge the gap between academic institutions and industry, ensuring that STEM graduates have pathways to apply their skills locally. Thank you for watching, and I see you next time on Talking Development.